Now let's discuss the third part of today's class, that is Karl Marx and environmental sociology. Unlike Weber and Durkheim, perhaps Karl Marx was much close to sociological analysis of nature. So, environmental sociology to a great extent has been influenced by the Marxian sociology or Marxian analysis. Or we may say that there is a close affinity between environmental sociology and that of neo-Marxism. Dunlap and Cotton in their work identifies four factors for which environmental sociology is close to neo-Marxism, or the neo-Marxist discourse and environmental sociology share certain kind of close affinity, certain kind of close relationship. To begin with, Dunlap and Cotton says that both neo-Marxism and environmental sociology as critical perspectives. In other words, environmental sociology makes a critique of the parental discipline of sociology because of its negligence of environmental factors, and similarly, neo-Marxism also criticizes, or neo-Marxism also develops a critique of its mainstream Marxism or neo-Marxist principles. So, neo-Marxist paradigm may be understood as a critique to the mainstream paradigm of Marxism. Secondly, both neo-Marxism and environmental sociology exhibit a critical posture towards capitalist industrialization and accumulation and growth. Both these perspectives, environmental sociology and neo-Marxism, are critical towards capitalist growth. They are critical towards capitalist accumulation. Thirdly, both environmental sociology and neo-Marxism regard environmental degradation as a contradiction to the development of modern society. Environmental sociology believes that we need to understand the natural limits, we need to understand the ecological limits, and any ignorance of the ecological limits create a contradictions in capitalist development, that which in other words means that it is impossible to carry out development unmindful of the ecological limits. Likewise, neo-Marxism also believes that environmental degradation creates a contradiction to the process of capitalism, because capitalism depends upon resources, and it is resource degradation which creates a contradiction within capitalism. And finally, Dunlap and Cotton says that both neo-Marxism and environmental sociology are essentially materialist perspectives, that we can make a sense of the reality only when we see the material perspectives, that the reality is contextualized in the matter, and understanding the material reality is important to make a sense of the social reality. Now, let us see that how Marxism becomes relevant for environmental sociology, how our reading of Karl Marx or how our reading of Marxism will benefit us in understanding the nature-society interaction in a better way. Perhaps the Marxian concept of alienation, or Karl Marx concept of alienation, that becomes crucial to understand the relationship or to understand the relevance of Marxism to that of environmental sociology. Karl Marx says that, or Marxian capitalism says that, when social conflict between two principal classes or social conflict between two principal social groups in society increases, that not only alienates ordinary people from their jobs, but also leads to their estrangement from the nature. In other words, if you read Karl Marx's Capitalism, we understand that alienation is a process which is an outcome of the extreme stage of capitalism. When capitalism matures, alienation takes place. And Karl Marx mentions about three kinds of alienation. Marx mentions about alienation from the product, where human beings or labor become estranged from the process of production. Marx mentions about alienation from the process, where he says that the individual labor is alienated from the process of capitalism. And third and most importantly, Karl Marx mentions about alienation from the species being, or in other words, alienation from the society. So, therefore, a mature capitalism, or when capitalism matures, or when there is a great contradiction and conflict within capitalism, when capitalists are essentially trying to maximize their profit, that leads to a kind of alienation where labor is estranged from the fundamental structure of the society. The labor cannot associate herself or himself with the production process, with what he or she produces. The labor cannot associate himself or herself with the society. So, therefore, alienation can be understood as the central problem where the labor is estranged from the society. And when we see environmental sociology, perhaps we can understand alienation in a better manner when we see the capitalist agriculture. So, if you understand capitalist agriculture, or if you try to make a sense of agricultural or capitalist development in agriculture, we may see that capitalism is held responsible for a wide range of social problems or social ills, like overpopulation, resource depletion, and alienation of people from the natural world. So, it is Marxian analysis of the process of alienation which is central or which becomes crucial in environmental sociological literature. And in the context of agriculture or in the context of capitalist agriculture, the alienation takes the form where the labor, the agricultural labor, is detached from the land. It detached from the process of production, which is the land, which is a natural resource. So therefore, alienation takes place from the resource itself. So Marxian sociology helps us to understand that with mature capitalism or with rising capitalism, human beings are alienated from the resource itself. Human beings are alienated from the land itself. Human beings are alienated from the natural resource itself. We may here analyze, or we may here take into account, two important environmental sociological works to understand the relevance of Marxism in environmental sociology. I am referring to James O'Connor's work on Second Contradictions of Capital, and then we will discuss John Bellamy Foster's work on Metabolic Rift. To discuss James O'Connor's work, or to discuss O'Connor's work on Second Contradictions in Capitalism, we need to understand that there are two contradictions in capitalism. What O'Connor essentially highlights, that capitalism has two internal contradictions in itself. The first contradiction, which he says, that contradiction between labor and capital. And the second contradiction, or the second order contradiction, is between capital and environment. So let's see in detail what are these two contradictions. The first contradiction, or the contradiction in capital and labor, has been very clearly defined in Marxian analysis or in Marxian capitalism. When Karl Marx says that capitalism has the seeds of its destruction in its own womb, he essentially means that it is internal factors of capitalism which will lead to destruction in capitalism. And it is in this context that Karl Marx mentions about the internal contradictions in capitalism. So let's discuss in detail what is this internal contradiction in capitalism. Marxian analysis says that when capitalism matures, the capitalist or the bourgeoisie are in competition among themselves to make profit. And to make more profit, what they do is that they try to exploit the labor more. So therefore, the idea to get profit or the intention to maximize profit results in further exploitation of labor. And as capitalism increases, as exploitation of labor increases, that results in pauperization in society, that results in reduction in the wage rate. So what Marx mentions is that to maximize profit, what the capitalist will do, that the capitalist will reduce the cost of labor. So the wage rate will be reduced, and the capitalist will force the labor to work for more hours with less wage. So which otherwise is known as the process of surplus extraction from the labor. And it is this process of surplus extraction that will result in decreasing or diminishing the purchasing power of the labor. So therefore, we need to make a sense of the process of capitalism and how it creates a contradiction within itself. What Marx says is that when capitalism matures, that results in decreasing the wage rate, and decreasing wage rate results in pauperization of the labor and diminishing purchasing power of the labor. On the other hand, to maximize the profit, the capitalist will insist on more and more production. So therefore, a time will come in capitalism when there will be overproduction, there will be more and more products in the markets, and there are few buyers. There are few buyers because, first of all, the market is getting saturated, and secondly, the purchasing power of the larger population, the labor, is minimized or is getting reduced. So it is in this condition that creates a contradiction in capitalism. Karl Marx mentions about two kinds of capital, the variable capital and the constant capital. The variable capital refers to the labor, and constant capital refers to the machines. And to gain more and more profit, what Karl Marx says, that the capitalist will spend more on machines. So therefore, there will be greater mechanization, there will be greater use of machinery, and the labor's wage, or the wage rate to the labor, will be minimized. So that is a process, or that is the only way in which the capitalist will try to maximize his profit or maximize her profit. And Marxian analysis says that creates a process of contradiction within capitalism. So the labors will be estranged, the labors will be exploited, the labors will be alienated, and it is this alienation process or this estrangement process that will create a sense of class consciousness among the labor. And it is this class consciousness that will ultimately lead to the class war, or that will ultimately lead to the class struggle. So, therefore, what Karl Marx is trying to say, or what Marxian analysis is trying to say, that the cause of destruction of capitalism lies in capitalism itself. Now, coming back to our discussion, when we are trying to discuss about a second contradiction in capitalism, what is the second contradiction that James O'Connor is trying to point out? James O'Connor is trying to point out that besides the first order contradiction which Marx mentions in his work, there is a second order contradiction in capitalism. And the second order contradiction is between the capital and the environment, that when capitalism will mature, when there will be overproduction, when the rate of profit will reduce, that will result in expansion of capitalism, or that will result in degradation of resource. And as resources are degraded, resources will become scarce, resources will become limited. So, therefore, this limiting natural resources or this degrading natural resources would automatically increase the cost of production in capitalism, and that will lead to a fall in the profit. Like the first order contradictions which lead to decrease in the rate of profit and fall of capitalism or dismantling of the capitalist order, James O'Connor says that the second order contradiction or the second contradiction in capitalism will result in decreasing the profit. And profit will be decreased because as capitalism expands, overproduction takes place, that will result in extraction of more and more natural resources, and that will ultimately result in degradation and scarcity of natural resources. And as natural resources become scarce, as natural resources become limited, as they become more and more unavailable, that will raise the production cost in capitalism. And with rising production cost, capitalism is bound to fall. So, this analysis is very much crucial, or this Marxian analysis is very much crucial to understand the nature-society interaction in environmental sociology. So, therefore, James O'Connor's work of second contradiction is quite relevant in understanding the nature-society interaction, or in understanding the degradation of nature, or in understanding the process of capitalism. Now, let us move on to the second work, which emphasizes the relevance of Marxism in understanding nature-society interactions. Here, I am referring to the work by John Bellamy Foster, Marx Theory of Metabolic Rift. Bellamy Foster says that Marx provided a powerful analysis of the main ecological crisis of his day, the problem of soil fertility within capitalist agriculture, as well as commenting on other major ecological crises of his time. So, John Bellamy Foster takes the Marxian analysis or Marxian perspectives to understand the crisis of soil or to understand the crisis in agriculture. So, let us understand what is this Marx theory of metabolic rift. So, before that, what is metabolism? What we understand by metabolism? What Bellamy Foster says that metabolism is a process of coexistence with resource. It is a process of equilibrium with nature. And metabolism is defined, or it constitutes as the fundamental basis on which life is sustained and growth and reproduction becomes possible. So, therefore, the process of metabolism is a process of symbiotic relationship with nature. The process of metabolism is a process of equilibrium with the nature. It is a process of equilibrium relationship with nature. It is a process where life is sustained on earth. It is a process where growth and reproduction becomes possible on earth. So, therefore, metabolism is a process where human beings and nature remain in a stage of equilibrium. Whereas, when we see the process of capitalism in agriculture, or when we see the growth of capitalism in agriculture, what Bellamy Foster emphasizes that by 1860, the organic relationship among the human being and the resources was being seriously undercut by the practice of capitalist agriculture. So, taking clue for Marxian analysis, taking clue for Marxian sociology, Bellamy Foster tries to say that the organic relationship between human beings and the society, the metabolic relationship between the human beings and the natural world, is seriously getting rifted, is seriously getting destroyed because of growth of capitalist agriculture. So, it is capitalist agriculture which ultimately is resulting in estranging human beings from that of nature, which essentially is creating a rift between human beings and the nature. So, this theory, or Bellamy Foster's theory of metabolic rift, is an essential conceptualization of understanding the rift between, or the disjuncture between, the human society and its natural environment. So, taking the context of capitalism in agriculture, or taking the context of capitalist growth in agriculture, Bellamy Foster tries to analyze that it is the process of capitalism which is responsible for this estrangement from the nature. It is the process of capitalism which is responsible for this estrangement of human society from that of land, from that of the production process. So, therefore, what Bellamy Foster says that with rising capitalist agriculture, human beings or the society got estranged from the nature. The landowners were callously robbing the soil of its key nutrient by declining the recycle item. So, therefore, what Bellamy Foster says that capitalist agriculture, which essentially relies on profit, emphasizes more on production of cash crops, emphasizes more on production of monoculture. So, therefore, capitalist agriculture discourages natural recycling, because as we know that it is through the process of natural recycling, it is the process of crop rotation, it is the process of cultivating multiple crops that soil gets its own nutrient. Whereas, capitalist agriculture or capitalist development in agriculture emphasizes on making more profit from the soil, making more profit from the agriculture. And to get more profit from the agriculture, the capitalist or the capitalist agriculturalist will rely more on monoculture, will rely more on cropping same and same crop again, which will derive or which will give them more profit, and that will result in degradation of the soil nutrients. So, therefore, Bellamy Foster says that this is a process of contradiction in agriculture. So, what he describes metabolic rift as the estrangement of human beings from the natural world of the soil. So, this can be equated with the process of estrangement of workers or labor from the process of capitalism itself. So, in other words, Bellamy Foster's metabolic rift, by which he means the estrangement of agriculturalists from natural resource of soil, that can be equated with the alienation of workers from the factory. So, what Bellamy Foster is trying to argue that it is the development of capitalism in agriculture, or with the growth of capitalist agriculture, soil is getting degraded, and as the soil gets degraded, the agriculturalists get estranged from the resource, from the soil. So, therefore, Bellamy Foster's theory of metabolic rift is an important analysis to understand the rift, the gap or the contradiction that is created between human society and that of the nature, and in this case the agricultural land. If you try to answer the pertinent question that what results in degradation of soil, what are the factors which are responsible for degradation of soil, Bellamy Foster's analysis says that it is the rising capitalism in agriculture. Because the capitalist agriculture or capitalism process in agriculture emphasizes on maximizing profit, and in order to maximize profit, the capitalist agriculturist will emphasize on monoculture, they will emphasize on cash crops, they will emphasize on cropping the same profitable crops rather than rotating the crops and rather than the process of natural recycling. And as I told that, we know that it is through the process of natural recycling that the soil regains its nutrient. And the capitalist agriculture ultimately results in degradation of the nutrients from the soil, that results in soil degradation. And therefore, Marxian analysis becomes crucial here. Marx's frame of reference becomes important here. And we can come to an analysis that Marx becomes relevant for understanding resource degradation. Now, when we come back again to the Marxian sociology and the environmental sociology, we may realize that over the years, four broad areas of research, four broad schools of thought have emerged, which has been influenced by the Marxian analysis. There has been those who contended that Marx's thought was anti-ecological from the beginning to the end. In other words, one school of thought says that Marxian analysis has been largely irrelevant for environmental sociology, because Marxian sociology has been ignorant of what's happening in nature. Marxian sociology, starting from the beginning till the end, is unecological. There is another school of thought which argues that Marx provided illuminating insights to ecology. Marxian analysis is very crucial in understanding ecology, but ultimately Marxian analysis succumbed to the Prometheanism of pro-technology, and therefore it emerges as anti or unecological. So, this school of thought says that Marxian analysis is important to understand ecology, because ultimately in the process of production, in the process of capitalism, resources are used as an important input. So, therefore, we cannot understand nature-society interaction without taking into account Marxian analysis of capitalism, because it is the process of capitalism which ultimately degrades the nature. But again, what is important for Marx is not the process of resource degradation. And again, Marxian analysis believe that environmental problems would be eliminated as a result of abundance or post-capitalism. The Marxian analysis says that environmental problems are not important. What is important is the exploitation of classes. What is important is the caste-class conflict. And Marxian analysis somehow believe that environmental problems can be overcome, they can be solved once the society becomes socialist, once the capitalist order is dismantled. So, therefore, the solution for environmental problems in Marxian analysis is dismantling of the capitalist order. But we need to understand that what is missing here or what is problematic here is that both capitalism and socialism are essentially industrial in nature, that the industrialism is common to both capitalism and socialism. So, therefore, Marxian analysis that the problems of environment can be solved with socialism somehow doesn't influence or doesn't inspire this group of sociologists. The third school of thought believes that Marx provided an analysis of ecological degradation within agriculture, the one which we discussed just now. It is Bellamy Foster, it is the John Bellamy Foster, which believed that Marxian analysis is crucial to understand the process of agriculture, that the process of degradation in agriculture, the process of soil degradation in agriculture can be understood only from a Marxian analysis. And the fourth group of scholars or the fourth schools of thought believes that Marx developed a systematic approach to nature and environmental degradation. So, in other words, we find four labels of analysis so far as influence of Marxism in environmental sociology is concerned. There are one group of scholars which take one extreme, which believes that no, Marx is more or less irrelevant starting from the beginning to the end. And there is another group of scholars or another school of thought which believes that Marxian analysis provides a systematic approach to understand nature-society interaction. However, in between these two extremes, where one believes that Marxian sociology is irrelevant in understanding nature-society interaction, and the other extreme which believes that Marxian sociology provides a systematic approach to understand nature-society interaction, we find different perspectives which are critical to Marxism, which are critical to Marxian analysis, but at the same time finds relevance in Marxian analysis in understanding nature-society interaction. For example, Anthony Giddings pointed out that Marx demonstrated considerable ecological sensitivity in his earlier writings. So, what Anthony Giddings says that Marxian analysis is relevant in understanding nature-society interaction, but later or ultimately Karl Marx's analysis emphasizes more on the social process, on the social class conflict rather than what happens to the nature. Marx's concern with transforming the exploitative human relationship that is expressed in the class system doesn't extend exploitation of nature. The way in which Karl Marx has emphasized exploitation of society or exploitation in society, or the manner in which Marxian analysis analyzes exploitation of classes or exploitation of proletariat by the bourgeoisie, in the same way Marxian analysis doesn't examine exploitation of nature by the bourgeoisie. What Anthony Giddings highlights here is that it is the process of capitalism, or in a capitalist society it is the class of the bourgeoisie, the capitalist class, which is responsible for exploiting the labor as well as exploiting the nature, whereas Marxian analysis emphasizes on one side of exploitation, that is understanding, explaining, comprehending exploitation of labor by the capitalist, and by and large it ignores the exploitation of nature. And Marxism believes perhaps that exploitation of nature or problems of resource degradation, resource exploitation can be solved when we dismantle the capitalist social order. So, therefore, the solution to environmental problems as per Marxian analysis is dismantling the capitalist order. Likewise, Michael Redcliffe also points out that for Marx, environment serves as an enabling condition, enabling function, but all value was derived from labor, like I just mentioned just now, that for Marx, nature becomes an enabling factor. Environment becomes an enabling factor because it just aids the process of capitalism. It just contributes to the process of capitalism. But what is essence of capitalism, or what is essence of capitalist production, is the labor. Because it is the labor which produces the profit, it is the labor which produces the values. Nature is just a process which contributes, which aids or it is just an enabling condition. And human's relationship to nature remained unchanged in each phase of social existence. And Marxian analysis or Marxian historical materialism further says that human's relationship with nature perhaps remain more or less unchanged in different stages. And thus, this relationship cannot explain social change. What is important to understand social change is the relationship among the classes. That it is the class relationship, it is the class exploitation that is crucial to understand the process of social change. And Marxian analysis does not pay any attention in understanding the relationship between nature and society to explain the process of social change. So, now to conclude this class or to summarize this class, we may say that these three classical sociologists, Durkheim, Weber and Marx, can be of great help in understanding the nature-society interaction. Be it be Durkheim's division of labor, be it be Weber's rationalization, or be it be Karl Marx's alienation, these concepts provide significant insights to understand the nature-society interaction. While Durkheim and Weber has been less analyzed in environmental sociology, Marxian analysis or Karl Marx's capitalism has been of great influence in environmental sociology. And environmental sociology has been benefited to a large extent from the writings of Karl Marx, from the writings of Max Weber and from the writings of Emil Durkheim. Finally, coming to the prime readings for today's class, you can follow the e-text, the text module which is attached to this video lecture, and I have identified the following four important sources as primary readings. You should have a look at Hannigan's book Environmental Sociology, especially the chapter 1, first chapter. You should also look the book Sociological Theory and the Environment, Classical Foundations and Contemporary Insights by Rayleigh Dunlap and Frederick Bottle, especially the first chapter is important. And then there are two specific articles which deals with the Weberian sociology and the environment and the Marxian sociology and the environment. I am referring to two important works by John Bellamy Foster. Bellamy Foster's piece on Weber and environment, published in American Journal of Sociology in 2012, and Bellamy Foster's article Marx's Theory of Metabolic Rift, Classical Foundations of Environmental Sociology, published again in American Journal of Sociology in 1999, are of great help to understand how we can make sense of Durkheim and how we can make sense of Weber and Karl Marx in environmental sociology. Now, to conclude today's class, we discuss about what insights we can gain from classical sociology in our understanding of nature-society interaction. So, you go through these readings, then follow the e-text that is attached to this video lecture, and if you have any doubts, we can discuss that in the discussion forum. And with this, I almost come to an end of understanding the field of environmental sociology, and in the coming class, we will discuss environmental sociology in the Indian context. Or the title for the next module is Emergence of Environmental Sociology in India. Thank you.